Hi everyone, welcome to Data and Visual Analytics. My name is Polo Chau. I'm an Associate Director of MS Analytics Program and also an Assistant Professor in the College of Computing in the School of Computational Science and Engineering. So today we're going to cover some of the introductory information of this class. So we'll start with the very first question that a lot of students would have is how do I address me? So there are two ways. One is the grammatically correct way and the other is the grammatically incorrect way but very popular way. So the correct way would be Professor Chow or Dr. Chow, and the incorrect way, but very popular way, is Professor Polo or Dr. Polo. So it's actually up to you, however you want to address me, that's fine. And if you want to know a lot more about my professional life, you can just Google Polo Chow, and you can see everything from my publication to my research group. So everything is open book. So today, what I'd like to give you is a little bit idea about what I do for research and how it's related to this class so that you can understand why you might want to listen to me. So this is a snapshot of some of the students who are working with me right now. So PhD student at the top, master's student on the left, and undergraduate student on the right. And you might notice that I like to name things after myself. So I name my own group the Polo Club of Data Science. You'll see a lot of systems that I like to name include Polo in it. So we work with really large data set. So some of the data that you might be familiar with would be, say, the internet, which is a 50 billion web page data set. So the nodes here in this graph would be, say, web page, and the length would be web links. Or a Facebook graph, 1.2 billion users. The user in Facebook would be the nodes in the graph, and then the edges would be friendship. There are actually a lot more data sets like this, such as on Twitter, who follows whom, or Amazon, who buys what. So the nodes or the items here in this graph would be, say, the customer and also the product. So you connect customer to a product if the customer has purchased that product. Cell phone network, who calls whom, or in biology, protein-protein interaction. So some of the example data set that we analyzed are shown in this table. So the largest one is the second row, which is a graph from Symantec. So it describes over 30 billion edges, or 37 billion machine file relationships. So in this graph, the nodes are either machine or file. So if a machine has reported a file, then there's an edge connecting them. So whenever I show this graph, I also like to make a small disclaimer, which is that we not only want to work with large data set, but we also work with small data set. Actually, it's very important that when you want to develop methods to work with large data set, you need to test it first on a smaller data set. So actually, I'm stealing the quote from my colleague, John Stasko. So he says, small data also needs love. So we work with both small data set and also large data set. And having all these large amount of data set, you might say, great, so we can do a lot of exciting things. You can cure diseases by analyzing these data. You can look at the shopping trend and so on. But I would also argue that there's a challenge of analyzing these large amount of data. And often I would just summarize all of this challenge into a single number, number 7. So number 7, actually, there's a first part of what I'm going to say. So there is also the second part, which is plus or minus 2. So this is a very famous Miller's Law, which is a cognitive psychologist. It says that the number of items an average human can hold in the working memory is actually really, really small, 7 plus or minus 2. And you know that these days, with the help of computer or the reliance on computer, it's actually much smaller, probably 5 plus or minus 2 if you're lucky. Right. So what that really means is that even though we have access to this large amount of data, really large graph, billion scale graph data, what we really want to help people do is to condense all of them or distill all of that into a small number of really relevant, important things that people can hold in their working memory or things that are really important, relevant to them. So that brings us to a really popular slide. You probably have seen this many, many times in a lot of talks, which is to transform data into insights. So everyone can say about it, right? So here I'm also saying transforming data into insights, but how do we exactly do that? So our approach for analyzing all these amount of data or doing the distillation is to take advantage of techniques from two areas. One is data mining, and the other is human-computer interaction, HCI for short. So in data mining, its focus is on automated techniques. So examples will include like summarization, clustering, classification, and so on. And because they're automated, often they're a lot more scalable. They can easily scale to million, billions of items. And on the other hand, HCI, human-computer interaction, what their focus is to help people understand data in a very intuitive way. So their focus will be on interaction techniques, visualization techniques, and so on. And they will focus more on how to help people drive the analytics or analysis using iterative user-centered approaches. And because they are more manual in nature, so they would be slightly less scalable, maybe scaled thousands of items or so. So interesting thing is that both areas actually have long been developing methods to help people to analyze data. But traditionally, there's less communication. So our research is how to combine these two areas, take the best of both worlds. So they can take the scalability, the automation, and also the flexibility from human-computer action to help people make sense of data. So what's relevant to this class is that our approach of combining data mining and HCI is actually what this class is all about, combining computation and also the human aspect, human intuition. So how do we leverage human's perception, amazing perception and capabilities to analyze data? So computation plus human interaction. So specifically, how do we actually do that? Right? So we have computation, very automatic, very fast. And then the interactive visualization, user-driven, very flexible. But how do we actually combine them? So here's a quick example. So imagine you are someone working at a telecommunication company. And your boss would say, so we have collected a lot of data, actually billion scale data, and about a customer. So each node in this graph would be, say, a customer. And an edge connecting two customers would be, say, one person has called the other one. So there's an edge connecting them. And having all this data now, we want to use this data to increase the revenue of the company. So how do we do that? So this is actually a very common problem or issue today, is that a lot of companies have access, or they already have collected a lot of data, but then they may not necessarily know how to best use them. So in your case, you say, OK, I have this access to data, then what do I do about it? Right? Maybe you want to find something new, something novel, something that I did not know about. So if you're using traditional techniques, let's say in human-computer interaction or in visualization, then you can first try to visualize this data. On your right, you see this very beautiful figure here. You see all the nodes, the high-degree node, and as like bright stars, for example. But that's probably all that you can do. So you have very pretty picture. Actually, we have a name for it. We call it a beautiful hairball. So as in, it's very pretty to look at, but not so much you can do about it, right? So identify the bright spot, and that's pretty much it. So in this case, you might then use techniques from the computation side, let's say from data mining or machine learning. Particularly, you can use a class of method we call outlier detection to pick out things that might be a little abnormal, like things that are out of ordinary. So show in red here. And maybe they can even do better. They would help you rank them. They would say, so these are the five most interesting, most anomalous, for example, that you might want to look at. But often, this is where they stop. So meaning they would say, so look at these five, and trust me, so these are exactly the things that we want to look at. But in practice, we know that's not sufficient, because we want to know why. Why do you think, why do you say this is the most important thing that I should spend my time on? So this is a time where the interactive visualization can be really helpful. For example, using techniques as simple as just looking at the connection between the first four items, you might see that they actually form a clique. So a clique is a fully connected graph. So in this case, there are four nodes, so four fully connected nodes. So in this data, so since each node is a person and an edge would be a phone call, so that means these four people have called each other, right? So imagine instead of four, now you have 20. 20 of them fully connected, 20 node clique. That may mean that probably it's the 20 people in a big family who call each other, or maybe they're up to no good. So these may be maybe bad guys collaborating or kind of conspiring and so on. Right? So just looking at a connection, you can also see, so the first four may actually be interesting or suspicious. So similarly, if you provide the right interaction technique for a user to, say, expand the neighborhood of the last one, the fifth one, then you may see that this is the center of a star. So in this particular data, that means this could be a telemarketer who makes a lot of phone calls to people, but those individuals do not know each other, so which is why you have a star network. So that was a possibly oversimplified example of what I mean by combining techniques from data mining and interactive visualization. So overall, what we want to do is to how to best combine these two areas so we can develop techniques and methods that are not only scalable, but also interactive and usable. So a key here is actually usability. So we can have tools that are really powerful, very interactive, very scalable. But if no one knows how to use it, well, then people can't really use it. So that's really important. So scalable, interactive, and usable. So not only I say that that's important, actually, Einstein also said it's important. So often this quote that you see here is attributed to him. But in reality, it may or may not be actually what he said. But nonetheless, so what does it say? So it says computers are incredibly fast, accurate, and stupid. Human beings are incredibly slow, inaccurate, and brilliant. Together, they're powerful beyond imagination. So the key here is really how to take the best of both worlds. Take the speed of computation, and then the intuition, the creativity of human beings, and then combine them, merge it in the best way possible. So in the Polo Cup of Data Science, we have a number of projects that go in this vein, so such as the Apollo system, which combines machine learning and visualization to help people explore large networks. So that's not a typo, by the way. There's only one L because I put my name in it. And then another follow-up work we call Kalina is how to do the kind of scalable graph exploration not on the desktop, instead on any modern day browser, such as on your mobile phone. Of course, you can also run on a desktop. So in the same vein, we also develop a system called Visage, which is to help people find graph patterns in a large graph. So it won the Sigma Best Demo Award honorable mention. So the goal here is how to help people find interesting patterns without writing a lot of complex code. For example, in a movie data set, you may want to say, I want to find two directors who could direct two movies, and those movies cast the same actor. So conceptually, it's a pretty simple query. But if you were to write out all the code, it's actually pretty long. So it's what you see on the lower right. So Visage is a tool to help people more visually or more interactively find these kind of patterns without writing that complex code. So going back to this query here, you may wonder, do we actually have such a pattern? So actually, yes. So if you're a movie fan, you will know that there's a Coen brother, and they like to cast George Clooney in a lot of movies. So there you go. That's one pattern. And more recently, we also apply similar techniques combining human intuition and also the power of computer to help people explore and understand deep learning models. And some of you who are catching up on the news know that deep learning is where all the buzz is. So, but a shortcoming of deep learning is that it's often viewed as a black box. So how do we help people open up this black box? So Activist is a work that we do, collaboration that we do with Facebook, and it's now deployed on Facebook's machine learning platform. So often, all of these tools that we develop is in the context of my application area, which is cybersecurity. So you will know that for a lot of faculty members, actually, they will have at least one or more application area. That is where they often apply the research techniques that they've developed to solve real-world problems. So in my area, or my main application area is cybersecurity. So we have done work such as working with Symantec to develop very scalable billion scale, in this case, a system that can flag malware. So Polonium and ESOP are two such systems. They're published in SDM 2011 Data Mining Conference, and also the KDD Conference and other data mining conference. So both of these tools are now deployed and patented. So if you use any of the Symantec tool, then you are using part of Polonium and ESOP. And another example could be, say, finding fraud on eBay. So as in people, the bad guy get your money, but then they don't deliver an item. So that's a serious problem, as you may imagine, on auction. And also, we extend our techniques to detecting fake review, such as on Yelp, and this work called Marco Polo, as in. So he won the Best Paper Award at SDM 2014. So what we have looked at is what I do in my research group, and how they are related to what you're going to learn in this class. You will notice that there are a lot of common themes in the computation side and also in the visualization side. That's also the reason that I'm really excited about teaching this class, because it's very closely related to what I do. So I hope you will join me to explore and learn about these topics.